3, 2, 1, episode 4. In yes. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Alrighty, welcome back to this series of musical chats with me, JVT, and my brother Dave, DVT.
DVT.
Now, 1984 to pretty much the end of the
1984. 80s.
1984. Sex crimes. let's start with a really bad Eurythmics song. Wasn't that that?
Probably one of their worst, I'd suggest.
Easily.
Geez, 84 was a pretty big year for music, though.
Well, for me, 1984 is Red Sails and the Sunset by Midnight Oil.
Yeah, I've got a bigger one for you than that. Yeah. For me, 1984 is...
Dave's got some sort of encyclopedia.
It's just not cricket by the 12th man.
Oh, yeah, that was a big record. This is the Melbourne chart book, which features every song that hit the singles charts from 1956 to 2002.
Fantastic.
So we probably should have had this...
It's my Bible.
We probably should have had this out in previous episodes, but anyway.
Can we do that in post-production?
No, I don't think so.
No, that's...
So, you know, 84, well, that album came out by Midnight Oil. It was also the first big concert I went to.
That's big.
The Oils on the Red Sails and the Sunset tour. At the Sports and Entertainment Centre, which is now the Holden Centre.
Yes, go Pies.
The training facility for the Collingwood Football Club. But there's also the swimming venue at the 1956 Olympics in Melbourne too. Yes. So it's always been some sort of a...
It's done something in terms of that social fabric of Melbourne.
But that was the start of a 30-year up to now concert-going
experience.
Yes. Yeah, that was a great show too. I can't remember who was the support act, but
so I think I remember
driving up there with you, and it's great.
Let's just think about 1984 for a minute, and we'll get to that night shortly. But
yeah,
we're talking about Bruce Springsteen, big in 84.
Well, that was what was that? Born in the USA. That was huge the world over.
Pat Benatar.
Yeah.
George Michael was big in 84.
What about Laura Branigan with Gloria? Where'd Laura Branigan grow up?
Hey, tell me, JVT, where did Laura Branigan grow up?
She grew up in Armonk in Westchester County, New York.
Oh, do you know anyone who's from Westchester County in New York?
Yes, me.
Let alone West...
She went to the same high school as my... Well, the school district as my kids did. She went to Byram Hills High School. The late Laura Branigan, who passed away way too young.
She did.
Mm.
So I have to shoot that Cordia commercial.
Don't you think it's kind of sporty?
Yeah, that's right.
What about Michael Jackson, Thriller?
Yeah, Michael Jackson, big year for him in 84.
Yeah, yeah. Wham,
yep.
Oh, I'll tell you what else was out. Rebel Yell by Billy Idol came out in that year, I think.
Queen, that I'm going to break free.
We're just going to sit here listing songs off this fucking list now, aren't we? 1999 by Prince.
No, not really. But I think, I think locally 84. When did 20th Century by Chisel come out?
83 or 84, because they basically split up, didn't they?
Yeah, they did.
They had their Last Stand concerts.
They had the Last Stand concerts, which I think would turn into a film as well.
Yep. They filmed the shows at the Entertainment Centre in Sydney.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
So anyway, you mentioned the big Midnight Oil concert, and that was the Sports and Entertainment Centre.
I couldn't sleep for a week up to
that. Yeah, it was a pretty... we both actually went to their concert. I don't remember us spending any time together, but...
No, we were standing in the same vicinity, but I was just going mental. I remember standing there with my arms around some bloke who I'd never met before, just singing Oil songs.
He may be on this podcast.
So good on you, mate, if you're out there. Yeah.
Yeah, if you...
I was that smelly 15-year-old kid.
If you went to the Sports and Entertainment Centre concert in 84 from the Oils, say something in the comments below.
Yeah, call me. But no, that was great. We drove up in
Hoggy's 1976
Hoggy Subaru,
chocolate brown Subaru four-wheel drive, probably one of the ugliest cars ever made.
I don't know who else.
Sorry,
went.
Hoggy, it was.
Did Hoggy not go there? We had his car.
Nah, Hoggy was working, and I think he was his license was indisposed at the time. Ooh. And well, maybe it wasn't.
Maybe it wasn't Hoggy, but we're sorry about that if it did or it didn't happen.
That's right. Anyway, we had his car.
Hoggy, one of the great chefs of the world.
Oh, certainly.
Yeah, absolutely.
Certainly. Michelin 5-star.
Michelin 19-inch rims. Oh, he's got the giggles now. Nah, we'll keep that in. Cough button. Who else was at that concert? Was Jeff Grant at that concert?
I don't really remember who else was at that
Bruce
concert.
Bruce Lyon,
really,
maybe? I don't know. Well, there were a few
Jeff
of us.
Jeff Grant was.
I think there were about four or five of us there, yeah.
Yeah, and Bruce probably was as well. But I just remember it was the first concert I ever went to where there was some sort of audio-visual shit stuff hanging on the sides of the screen.
Yeah, right, okay.
And, it was really... and I think, yeah, probably because a lot of the songs had some sort of social commentary attached to them.
They had a video
they had videos.
The song, right.
Yeah, so yeah. I guess for a lot of oil heads that were there, they were probably there for the music more than anything. That message, the accompanying message, was sort of beamed as some imagery on the side. So, yeah, it was pretty cool. I remember that for some reason there was some weird blue... smoke machine that was I remember walking out. I remember I said to someone, geez, the weird blue light in this place is amazing.
It was the broccoli cigarettes people were smoking.
That's right.
Yeah, right.
I remember that walking out the other side and the doors open and going, thank goodness for some fresh air.
Dave had his Ventolin inhaler on his
That's right, the back gas.
Yeah, in the back.
So, but yeah, fantastic concert. I remember the sound, you could feel the bass bouncing off that back wall. Well, one of the complaints performers had of that venue was that the back wall, they got too much sort of
moving around too
fallback
much.
Feedback
yeah,
whatever,
right. Okay.
Off the back, and I think subsequently they put some sort of noise sound absorption material on the back wall, but I didn't have a very long venue life as a...
No, I don't think so.
I remember going to see Wet, Wet, Wet.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah, that's one in 1995 or 96 there, but I'm pretty sure...
Oh, in the mid-90s that was.
Yeah, I remember, but I think after that it didn't last very long after that.
Yeah, no, because I don't think any... Collingwood was still down at Victoria Park, so I don't think it was used for anything else, really.
Yeah, so...
But I reckon that started me off with... concerts, because I reckon next year, Booney and my mate Booney, how are you, buddy? We went and saw the Oils again at the South Melbourne Cricket Ground with the Divinals, Spy vs. Spy. And I remember they brought this rap band on and they lasted about 10 seconds because they got pelted with food and beer cans and stuff. So
1984 was also the time that I think, if I'm correct, 1984 was the year when... Hey Hey It's Saturday did a cross to the Melbourne Showgrounds. There was some huge concert up there with featuring the Hooks.
Oh, really?
No, okay. And Cheryl and Red were doing that sort of, you know, thing that they used to do. And I think as a result, that was kind of what got Red Simons onto
Hey Hey It's Saturday.
A permanent gig on Hey Hey It's Saturday.
Poor bastard. Yeah.
So, yeah. So 84 big. I think for me, Sports by the News was big album in 1984. The continuation of that that R&B rock sound thing, and it was a huge album too. It was worldwide. It was a huge album. So, Huey Lewis and the News went from bar band to to an internationally successful band. So,
yep, absolutely. So 85, that was my last year of high school, 85.
Yeah, well, 85, I think My Sex would call it a day by 1985.
Yeah, I think they put out Where Do They Go, and then that was about it, I think. Yeah.
Yeah, and yeah, INXS was starting to really hit their straps.
With that album, they had one of their best songs called Blue Day. It was on that last record, I think.
Fantastic.
Yeah, yeah. So INXS, 85, INXS would have had Kick or something like that. Or Listen Like Thieves, I think, was probably the... album.
Yeah, Mars Needs Guitars by the
Hoodoo Gurus.
By fantastic Hoodoo Gurus. So a lot of good
stuff.
That
was the Choose Life era. Wham.
That's right.
Wake Me Up Before You Go-Go and all that sort of stuff.
And yeah, that era of big concerts,
yeah,
where anyone could get in, you're a kid, adult, whatever, you just got through the door, and all those big, you know, showground type venues.
Yeah, I think Springsteen came through. Yeah, a lot of big outdoor
concerts. Yeah, Countdown was starting. Molly was starting to really nail a lot of those big international interviews, and you know, he became sort of, you know, best buddies with Elton John, Rod Stewart.
Well, I mean, Sounds with Donny Sutherland was still a big show, and
yep.
You got the other shows we probably missed, called Night Moves with Lee Simon, Lee Simon's a legendary
from Eon
DJ who just recently retired, I think, after being at Triple M and Eon for 30 plus years. Yeah, there were a couple.
There was a
Rock Arena with Suzanne Dowling, maybe. Was that her?
What was the one with Barzia on?
Barzia Bonkowski
on SBS.
Yeah.
Maybe that was a bit later.
Speaking of Barzia, a great band called Painters and Dockers from Melbourne.
Electric Pandas.
A great song called Barzia. Electric Pandas, like Big Girls versus Breakup.
Let's gamble.
Let's gamble.
Take a chance.
And also they had that Coke ad too, didn't they?
It's real, it's hot, it's da 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 da. Yeah.
Coca-Cola is shit.
It's totally now.
It's showing them how.
But who was
Lynn Buckfield.
Yeah, Lynn. She ended up going on having a fantastic career in journalism.
She probably, well, no, I don't know. Was it journalism or producing?
Producing, was it?
Yeah, like Four in Corners, that space, 60 anyway. Minutes, those sort of shows.
Yeah, I love your work, Lynn.
Good on you, Lynn, if you're out there.
Yep. It's totally now.
But 1985 was the year I discovered the great punkish band Painters and Dockers, who also was also one of those bands with a brass section too.
Die Yuppie Die.
Die Yuppie Die, Nude School, all that sort of stuff. But my mate Booney and I and Shane Jenkins, if you're out there, Jenks, good on you, mate. Big Pistols fan. We went up to a geography lecture.
Yeah, right.
And we stayed at my grandma's place in the bungalow and snuck out down. We caught the tram down a queue to the Prospect Hill Hotel.
Fantastic.
Just to have a beer. And there was this band called Painters and Dockers playing in there. And by the end of the night, we're all pissed as farts. And there was probably about, I don't know, 15 people in the audience, and the last song, everyone in the audience was on the stage with the band, and the band were all completely nude. It was hilarious. But the Dockers still play today, and the legendary Paul Stewart on vocals.
What time did you get back to Banool Road in Surrey Hills?
Probably 2 a.m. somewhere. Like that. But Paul Stewart was a great. He used to write the music reviews and stuff in the Herald Sun.
Yeah.
And a great advocate for, I think, East Timor as well. Great guy, Paul Stewart. Painters and Dockers, legends.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was another little. That was a great little rock and roll. Live rock and roll story. Yeah. But then in 85, I was still in high school, so I probably didn't see that many. But record-wise, yeah, there was Red Sails and the Sunset by the Oils. I don't know. There's probably a stack of them. What about yourself, Dee?
Too many to list.
Yeah.
I remember going to the Falcons. You actually won some tickets for me on Billy Pinnell's radio show.
Yeah, on the album show. I remember ringing up.
Yeah, and, you rang up.
He had tickets, and I thought, well, I'm not going to be able to go.
I think I went with Jeff Grant. We went down. It was at what is now the site of the Novotel in St Kilda. What
the venue.
Was it the Palace or the venue?
The venue. Yeah, the old Earl's Court.
It was basically a beer barn, essentially.
Yeah, I saw heaps of beer. And from 84 to 1990, Booney, my mate Booney and I probably saw 20 shows there easily. Like bands like I saw the Oils in that room. Spy versus Spy from Sydney. Great Melbourne band called Cattle Truck.
Yeah.
Nick Barker and the Reptiles. I saw The Cult, that great band out of England, The Cult. Who else would I have seen there?
Did you ever see the Eurogliders?
Nah, don't think so. I reckon I saw one of Crowded House's last shows there too.
Yep.
Great venue. I remember going to an Oil show and it was upstairs in the big ballroom, and I thought this place is going to collapse any minute because the floor was just going up and down.
Yeah,
like that.
Bouncing.
It was unbelievable. That was a great a great live venue. Yeah, which you said is now a Novotel.
Yeah, it's pretty much where the Novotel Hotel in on the Esplanade.
Yeah, I mean, there are other great venues down there too. The Palais Theatre, which is still there. And also a place called the Palace, which was like a nightclub come... live venue. I saw heaps of bands.
Yeah, unfortunately, St Kilda lost a lot of its sort of architectural, quirky seaside history when a lot of those places got removed. And a lot of, I know that a lot of the locals have lamented their passing.
The Espy's just been redone and reopened in the last couple of months too, hasn't it?
The Esplanade
Hotel. Room. Yeah, but down the Palace there, I saw Public Image Limit. I saw the Sex Pistols in the 90s. Jason and the Scorchers, a great band from Nashville in 87 or something like that. The Angels at the Palais Theatre. I remember seeing the Angels, and Bob Spencer had broken his arm, play. And the great Jim Hocking, who would later play in Screaming Jets, I think, he stood in as a young fella and just blitzed him as Bob's replacement for that night. I remember Booney and I
pretty
rocking
big
up.
Shoes to fill.
I think we had front or second row seats at that show. It was great. Yeah, Jimmy the Human, Jim Hocking, great guitarist. So yeah, that was all good. 86 to 89. I reckon I started branching out into more. I probably started buying more Public Image stuff, which was more experimental than rock and roll. Yeah, your tastes mature a bit and you go off on tangents, probably a bit of The Cure, that sort of stuff as well.
Yeah.
How about yourself?
Just all sorts of stuff.
Yeah.
I think CD started to, when did you bought your first CD?
I bought my first CD and I didn't even have a CD player. It was called Vivid by Living Colour, great hard rock band, a black hard rock band out of New York City, and I saw them a couple of years ago in New York play. They still kick ass. So Vivid by Living Colour was my first CD.
The first CD I ever bought was from 1985, and it was Cos Life Hurts by
Uncanny X-Men. Yeah, wow.
Australian band. I think the CD had been pressed overseas somewhere because at that stage the disc hadn't been set up to produce CDs.
Yeah, right.
A lot of them were produced offshore and they cost a fortune.
Well, see, by this time, I moved to the city, to Melbourne, and I started going to record stores like Old Go-Go Records, Greville Street Records in the Paran there, Gaslight in Bourke Street, the top of Bourke Street, fantastic. One of the great record stores.
Yep.
They used to have their nude day every year. If you showed up in the bollocky, you get a free record of some sort.
Oh, fantastic.
But they closed down probably mid to late 90s, I reckon. But I had a bloke in there who used to, I'd walk in there and he'd go, "Hey, you've got to listen to this record," because that were the great days. You'd walk into a record store and someone actually knew what they were talking about.
Yeah, you really, it was really
just being a snotty nose
connection with someone who knew their stuff in the store, and they'd kind of be your recommendation person.
Absolutely. I think bands like probably Jason and the Scorchers, and later on bands like the Jayhawks out of Minnesota, he put me on as well.
Fantastic.
Mm. So there you go. 84 to 89.
Yeah, I think 89, you and I went to one of the concerts I'd been hanging out to for a while was Huey Lewis and the News, and there'd been all this sort of rumours about when they were going to come out to Australia because they'd had all this success through 84, 85, and then 86 and 87.
Yep.
And it was like, well, when are they going to come out? And I remember interviews with Huey on Eon. We'll be coming out. And it wasn't until about February 89, and they just not on the back of the release of Small World, the album After Fall, which was pretty much the album they made it, they wanted to make. It wasn't really designed to be a commercial album. And I think the only real two singles off that were Perfect World, Small World, with Stan Getz.
I remember seeing that. We saw them at the Tennis Centre, where they play the Australian Open tennis every year. And it took a while to get going, but by the end of that show, everyone was just going berserk. And yeah, they really, so they energy. Really did the.
They had the tower power of horns.
Yeah, yeah.
From the Bay Area, as the, yep. providing the brass as well.
And who, do you remember who was the support act?
Daryl.
Daryl Braithwaite. Yeah, the great Daryl. So Daryl from Darryl, Sherbet.
And Daryl, yeah, and that was on the back of Daryl having done
or Edge.
Edge.
Yeah. Edge, yeah.
So Edge came out in 88, I think. Some from of memory.
That. As the days go by.
Yep. Couple Sugar Train.
Yeah.
All that sort of stuff.
One Summer.
One Summer.
Yeah.
I'll Find a Way.
Yeah.
And so Daryl was there with his with a band, probably with Chuck Hargraves.
Chuck Hargraves, who would also was also in Uncanny X-Men.
So they were, yeah, they were the support act, and Huey did a couple of shows at the Sports and Entertainment Centre, and never came
Chris,
back.
I remember Chris Hayes throwing his towel up at us.
Yes.
I don't know what happened to that towel, but hopefully I washed it and
yeah.
didn't catch anything.
Chris Hayes, cool. fantastic yeah. jazz guitarist.
Great guitar, yeah, jazz guitarist, absolutely, yeah.
Yep.
But yeah, the great, some great concerts I saw in that period, 84, 89, I saw Bob Dylan at Kooyong Tennis Courts, which was the old lawn tennis court in Melbourne.
Was he playing tennis or...?
No, he wasn't. He was playing with Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers.
But how many people would that place have sat? What, 10,000 tops?
Probably heaps of people on the actual court area and then scattered around. I saw the Oils there too, and it was great. All of a sudden, the lights went down at the start of the concert, and then I can't remember what song it was, but Peter Garrett was right up the back at the top of the grandstand.
No, you wouldn't see that.
And a spotlight on him. Everyone was just going mental. That was
yeah, cool. I just the thing I remember about Kooyong was when they used to play the tennis, you hear the trucks roaring past on the southeastern freeway.
Or the
it was literally an open air tennis.
Or the 2 p.m. just pulling into Kooyong Station or something like that. Yeah. Well, our nanny and uncle lived about 200 metres from there.
They did around the back, yep.
Yeah. Because I remember Boonie and I stayed at... our auntie and uncle's place that night after that Dylan concert. So it was great. With Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, who are one of the great bands. Valet Tommy, it's been about a year since he passed on. I actually saw one of his last ever shows in Queens in New York last year, and about a month or two later he passed away, Tom yeah. Petty. So yeah, he was great. So yeah, Jason and the Scorchers from Nashville, we saw them both nights at the Palace in St Kilda. Hill, I saw them both nights. I saw them at the both at the Palace in St Kilda, yeah. Spy versus Spy, countless times. Oils, at least half a dozen or more times.
So we're talking the late 80s, and it's just before the dreaded pokies arrive on the scene. And you yeah. know, some of those, you think about some of those suburban beer barns, beer halls.
Yeah.
Beer halls, beer barns.
Well, with the Central Club in Richmond, we used yep. to see a lot of bands. The Corner Hotel. In Richmond, which is still a good live venue. They didn't succumb
still a great
to
place
it.
For music. Yeah. They have not dropped their ball, dropped the ball there.
Yeah, yeah.
The Matthew Flinders.
Oh, yeah, out in, when was that,
yeah,
Glen Waverley or something?
Yeah, out near, yeah. Well, was that Chadston out that
yeah.
way?
And there would have been the Sentimental Bloke Hotel out in Doncaster or wherever, yeah.
The, what was the one out near Ferntree Gully?
The Ferntree Gully Hotel? Or,
yeah, the Ferntree Gully Hotel's still been a live yeah. music venue.
Stages at the Manhattan. I remember seeing that Ian Moss play out there. I lost my watch on the rotating... dance floor.
The Burvale?
The Burvale? I think the Burvale. I don't know if bands still play the Burvale, but geez, the Burvale is a.
There was another one near Baronia place. Somewhere. Oh, I can't remember the
well,
name.
Well, there would have been the.
Well, there was the Pier Hotel in Frankston.
Not the Croxton Park out in Essendon or wherever that is.
Yeah. The Pier Hotel in Frankston, that was a massive live venue.
Yeah. Yeah, the 21st Century Dance Club.
Yeah, yeah, if you see a lot of old sort of.
Bill posters. The bands like the yeah, Oils the and Oils the Angels, they all played out there, yeah. Yeah.
So
absolutely.
Yeah, a lot of those sort of unofficial live albums.
But then you would have had little bars like Martinis where the yeah, Falcons Martinis. Play would have played.
That's
there
right, yeah.
Too. Yeah. Absolutely.
So and unfortunately a lot of those places the music performing area
Bombay Rock.
Was yeah, was a similar size to what was required for poker machines. So,
yeah, yeah.
Yeah, there was certainly a correlation between the introduction of pokies in the Victoria and the sort of demise of you know, full-scale live music.
Well, then they stopped having shows at Festival Hall for years too, but I still think every now and then they have...
Yeah, and I think Festival Hall's going to be saved as well.
Yeah.
In some shape or form.
In West Melbourne there.
Yes, that's right.
Yeah. Well, they used to have wrestling in the 70s.
The Cranium Crusher.
That's right. Who was that? Who did that song, Over the Ropes?
Let's Go Over the Ropes.
Andrew Duffield from the Models, was
yeah,
it?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
Classic. Classic stuff.
Bam, bam. Thank you, man.
So what sort of shows would you have seen apart from Huey and Lewis in that era, you reckon?
Well, I'm trying to think who I did see, to be quite honest. I did see Darryl Braithwaite down here. I saw Joe Camilleri down here as well. I saw
Hoodoo Gurus.
I saw no, I didn't see the Hoodoo Gurus in Melbourne. I saw Metal as Anything somewhere. I can't remember.
Yeah,
where.
We used to see them plenty of times in the.
Yeah, in I the saw the Uncanny X-Men a number of times.
I reckon it was the first time I saw Richard Clapton was probably late '80s, down in St Kilda somewhere. The Radiators, overseas bands, though. I'm trying to think of what band. The Cult, which is probably one of the loudest concerts I've ever been.
Where were they from?
They're from England. The support band.
Oh, I know. They're named after the royal family.
Oh, the Cult.
The Cult, yeah.
The support band was a band called the Lime Spiders from Sydney, who are a great alternative underground sort of band.
Yep.
Don't know if they still play anymore. Their lead singer's name was Mick Blood. That was always cool. Nice. I remember seeing them years later in the 90s in a pub in Annandale in Sydney, and I reckon there was about four of us in the audience. But great band, the Lime Spiders. Yeah. So, yeah, there you go. 84 to 89. I finished high school, started work, and moved to Melbourne.
Yep.
Yeah. There you go.
Fantastic. The 80s, what a decade.
So that's a wrap for the 80s, I reckon, Dave.
Yeah, I think we've done it. We've probably missed a few bits, but we can come back with a revised version at some stage.
We can always do a few.
That's right. Anyway.
Extras. All right, well, from me, that's JVT and him.
Yeah, DVT.
Brother Dave. It's that's a wrap for episode 4.
With a deep vein.
Rock on. See you later. Bye.